Well, thank you very much, Madam Nyerere, for and also for the Kenya Arena Association Committee for the honor to participate in this first ever virtual conference. I want to take us through the hemodialysis model in Kenya. And to start us off is that chronic kidney disease has emerged as one of the most as a major public health concern. And according to 2010 Global Burden of Disease Study, CKD was ranked 27th in the list of the causes of total global deaths. And by 1990, it had risen to 18th position. It had risen to 18th position by 2010. Therefore, in two decades between 1990 to 2013, we see that the mortality from CKD had increased by more than 100% and had been ranked among the top causes of mortality globally. This increase resulted in the increase in mortality, even in the remote regions, especially to those areas where it is very difficult to access services, health services. So worldwide, more than 1.4 million individuals with end-stage renal disease receive renal replacement therapy, which includes diuretic therapies and kidney transplantation. The mean growth of end-stage renal disease population is estimated at 8%. With this in mind, kidney disease should be a global public health priority because of the rising numbers and the associated mortality. Across the home now in Kenya, according to the KRA data, though not published, there has been tremendous growth in the number of facilities offering hemodialysis services across the country, as we will see along this presentation. The number of hemodialysis units have risen from 10 by year 2006, and as per today, 2020, we have close to 204 dialysis units, and this comprises both of the public sector and the private sector. Where the number of patients on chronic hemodialysis has increased from merely 300 to actually, this number is for 2019. So by now we should even be closer to 4,000, the number of patients who are receiving hemodialysis. The centers offering hemodialysis are both, as I've said earlier, in the public sector, run by the government of Kenya, and the private sector, where we have private and faith-based institutions offering the hemodialysis services in the country. We will see that by the year 1979, when we had the first ever renal center, which was established at the Kenyatta National Hospital, which is the largest teaching and referral hospital in our country. Then between the year 2008 and 2013, we had five existing dialysis units in the public sector, and these were mainly in the Raja towns of Nairobi, Eldoret. We had Coast, we had Kisumu and Nakuru. Then by 2015 and 2018, there was that capacity that had been increased. There was work that was ongoing to see all the county hospitals operate a renal unit. Therefore, we had a total of 49 dialysis units, that is the 47 counties, and then the two national referral hospitals by then, which were Kenyatta National Hospital and the Moi Referral and Teaching Hospital, bringing the total to 49. In the same year of 2018, there was some variation, and the government had seen that we had 12 centers which were experiencing very many patients, an influx of patients, and therefore those counties or centers were added some more machines, dialysis machines, and then we had other five additional centers that were coming up to make a total of 54 centers. This upscaling of services started gaining momentum in 2011
where we had a task force to upscale the renal services in Kenya, which was set up by the Kenya Renal Association. And this was following an outreach that had taken place at Kisumu, where this idea of having more centers or distribution of renal centers across the country, where the idea was born. And then in 2012, the patients also came in, and because of the suffering they were experiencing, there was strong lobbying from this group of patients pushing the government to improve the state of renal services in the country, and more so the hemodialysis services by then. Then 2014 came, where the government of Kenya took it up and floated the tenders and the hemodialysis to supply dialysis services in all the 7 counties and the 2 referral hospitals as of rooted area. Then 2015, the project took place, the implementation was commenced, and the very first dialysis unit to start under this government program started at Machakos County Referral Hospital. Then 2016, we had now the government of Kenya coming in through the National Insurance, National Hospital Insurance Fund, NHIF, and a policy came up, and the government started catering for the cost of hemodialysis using through the National Hospital Insurance Fund. This is very, very significant, as we will see, because earlier on, even with the increase of renal services, many patients could not afford the cost of hemodialysis. Earlier on also, with the six or so centers, patients were cost sharing. NHIF could pay a part and the patient could pay a part. But now come 2016, we saw a great shift, and the government started paying for the dialysis services, and which this was really, really a good thing. 2019 to date, actually, we have now 55 facilities that are offering dialysis services in the public sector. This includes 47 counties and 5 additional centers. And then we have the 2 referral hospitals. We have now the most, the newest referral hospital, Kenyatta University, in this number. So we have a total of 55 facilities in the Republic of Kenya under the Ministry of Health offering dialysis service. And then we have many private and faith-based centers, close to 150 centers offering hemodialysis services. When you look at the trend of growth in the hemodialysis model or center or service in the country, when we look way back 1995, we will see the number of doctors, the number of renal nurses, the number of centers, the number of patients who could access services were way too low, because it was not accessible then, and the cost, the centers were also not there. But when you compare that now, over the years, you will see there is a tremendous rise in the number of nephrologists. You will see there is a tremendous rise in the number of trained nephrology nurses. And you will see there is a tremendous increase in the number of dialysis units in the country. And you also see this has translated to quite a number of patients being able to access hemodialysis services, rising all the way from merely 100 all the way to more than 4,000, the number of patients who are able to access hemodialysis services in our country as of today. This is a map that I borrowed from, it is showing the counties and where the hospitals are located. And you will see, actually, this is as per 2019. I wasn't able to access on time the current one, because the country should now be green all over, because it means all the centers under the Ministry of Health are offering services as at today. So this is a plus, because initially the centers that were offering services were just concentrated in the major cities. But now, regardless of where one comes from, each county, we have at least one renal
renal unit that is able to offer hemodialysis services. And this has worked to reduce the distance which the patients could travel to be able to access the hemodialysis service. Now, if we look at the support program for the hemodialysis program in this country, we've seen earlier how it started, but we can see one of the greatest support that for this program is the Ministry of Health. The government of Kenya came up with this managed equipment service project, and through this, we have now been able to see that in the public sector, in the public hospitals, in each county, level five hospital, you can be able to access dialysis services. So this is courtesy of the Ministry of Health, and I can say this has really worked to support the dialysis of the renal patients in this country. The number two support for this dialysis program in the country is through the National Hospital Insurance Fund, as I also earlier alluded, which currently is able to offer Kenya shillings 9,500 twice a week as a reimbursement for the dialysis services. This has gone a long way to support the kidney patients. Initially, for those who could not afford, they could easily succumb, increasing the mortality rate. But now, through the government of Kenya and through the National Hospital Insurance Fund, the patients are able to have access to access services supported by the National Hospital Insurance Fund. And for those who manage and who are prepared for kidney transplantation, through the same program, they are able to get 500,000 as an initial as a support for the kidney transplant. So National Hospital Insurance Fund has come in a big way to support the program. Though there is still a lot of lobbying to see whether the National Hospital Insurance can be able to support the post-kidney transplant medication for patients who have now progressed from dialysis to kidney transplantation. The other support that this program in our country is gaining is through the association, and we have the Kenya Renal Association and the Kenya Nephrology Association, Kenya Nephrology Nurses Association. These two associations have played a very key role to oversee the success of hemodialysis program. They have lobbied for it, they have fought for it, they have fought for the patient's right to see that these patients can be able to access services wherever they are. And also, they are also working to see that at least the quality of services is improving in these centers. The other support for the hemodialysis program is through the government body, Kenya Medical Supplies Agency, and this is supporting the hemodialysis program in the counties through the government program and policy by ensuring adequate supply of dialysis consumable to the county hospital. This still remains as a challenge, as we will see, but at least with time, we hope that this can be able to gain roots and it can be able to support our hemodialysis program fully. The other support we have seen is through the East African Kidney Institute. This also has come up very strongly. This is one of the major training institutes that have come up of late, well funded by Development Bank to foresee that this country gets a center of excellence in the area of nephrology. And it is getting involved in the training of nephrologists. These are the doctors, the training of nephrology nurses, and also the training of other cadres, the laboratory people, the vascular surgeon, the urologist, the nutritionist, name them all. Through the East African Kidney Institute, we are gaining support because we are having training a whole a holistic kind of program that will see that we have been able to get a center of excellence for renal services in this country, not just hemodialysis, but a wholesome program for the nephrology services. So this is just to name but a few of the centers that are working to support the hemodialysis program in our country. To move us on, we can look at the challenges that the hemodialysis program has experienced and is experiencing in our country. And one of the problems that we are encountering is the many cases of patients requiring urgent dialysis and they are getting temporary catheter, meaning the referral program needs to be worked on, because most of the patients you will get in our dialysis program, you find them, they are coming in late, they are referred in late, and the access they are getting is temporary catheter, they are very sick. So we may need to work on our program to see that these patients are able to be followed from CKD stage 1, 2, 3, and they are prepared adequately before they are able to access the dialysis services. So we can have them being referred, having been prepared through the clinics, they can come with either long-term accesses, AVF, and long-term catheters. In some counties, distance to dialysis center is still relatively long. We have places like, an example like Marsabit, where you have only the government center and a patient coming all the way from Moyale to Marsabit, over 200 kilometers. Places like Voi, people who are coming from Mwatate and the borders of Kenya and Tanzania, or traveling all the way to Voi to access services. So you find that even if there is a center in each county, but the distance the patients may require to travel to access the services, in some of those centers is relatively long. And this means they may require to partner either with the private sector, or the government may need in future to have these counties get additional centers. Then availability of dialysis units. Despite the many units, they are quickly filling up. Patients have to be turned away. This means that availability of space in the dialysis units. We have some of the centers acting very strict. They only accommodate a specific number of renal patients, meaning if they can handle 15, the 16th patient and upward, they are turning them away. And this is a real challenge, because once these patients are turned away, then it means they have to try and access these services elsewhere. And this translates to costs. This translates to mortality, because some of them cannot afford to do that. And therefore, this is a real challenge whereby it may need to be addressed by some of the suggestions that we will see. Then we still have shortage of trained personnel. As much as we have seen the number of nurses, nephrologists, biomeds, vascular surgeons are being trained through our training institutions, because we have other institutions other than IAKI. But as we speak, this program is still, rather the hemodialysis program in our country is still experiencing shortage of personnel, because you find a center that has 5 nurses, 2 nurses, 10 nurses, but if you compare that to the number of patients they are required to serve, then it still translates to shortage of trained personnel. And therefore that means, as we will see, we will need to work on this. Another factor is the issue of vascular access creation, because of lack of vascular surgeon. Then this fistula sometimes infection, thrombosis, and then the patients have to be referred to the main referral hospitals. In some counties, there is a challenge of water availability and water quality. And this proves a challenge, because without water, there is no hemodialysis. Costs of medication. As much as National Hospital Insurance Fund is paying and reimbursing, we still have some centers that are not offering EPO and iron through the NHIF program. The policy is not very clear to them. They have their own policy as individual autonomous institution, and therefore some of the patients are unable to cater for this cost of erythropoietin and iron. Therefore, this translates to another challenge in terms of anemia, renal anemia management. Then the cost of screening. not just for HIV, hepatitis B and C, but also laboratory tests. We have centers where NHIF is paying, we have centers where NHIF is not paying, and therefore patients have to pay out of pocket, and therefore maybe screening for this becomes a challenge. Vaccination in many centers for hepatitis B and also vaccination for the dialysis patient is not taking place. And this is a real challenge for our hemodialysis program, because if you're not screening your patients for hepatitis B, there is a serious risk for cross infection, contamination, and you could have all your patients in your unit contracting hepatitis B. So therefore, this needs to be taken very seriously. It needs to come up very well that all patients have to be screened before hemodialysis and also every 3 to 6 months for hepatitis B, for HIV and such. Then the other challenge we have is the number of patients going for kidney transplant. It is still very low, and that means the hemodialysis program is still congested. And therefore, we will need to encourage patients and to have our patients prepared and have an exit plan in terms of kidney transplantation. Then lack of support for peritoneal dialysis to complement hemodialysis. We've heard from our previous presenter, Madam Dr. Grace Garuya. She has spoken very passionately about peritoneal dialysis and why we need to embrace peritoneal dialysis. Because if we can be able to embrace this, even for those patients whom we've seen are traveling relatively long distances to access hemodialysis services, if we embrace peritoneal dialysis and we have the solutions ready available and in relatively affordable amount, then we will be able to sort out the hemodialysis program by complementing it with other patients accessing peritoneal dialysis, which is equally effective modality of dialysis. Now, as pertains to supply of dialysis consumable, I've spoken and I've met several nurses and visited several of the renal units, and you will still find that up to date, we still have some units that close because of lack of consumable. And I wonder, when you close for 1 week, for 2 weeks, it's really, really stressing to the patients, because where do they go? Once the unit has been closed, how do they access their dialysis services? And this has come up because of the uncoordinated supply of dialysis services. As much as it is being tried to, the government is trying to solve this through KEMSA, but you still find there are challenges because each county has its own, it's autonomous, health was devolved, and therefore this is a challenge to the program, and it's bringing some inconsistencies when it comes to offering of services. Then there is minimal support from the county government when it comes to the running of renal units. This at least is getting sorted out with time, but you will still find some county officials who do not understand the importance of a renal unit and why it has to run, why it has to be supported with training, to be supported with consumables, to be supported with everything. So once you have very minimal support, then it is very demoralizing to the service providers, the nurses, the doctors, and all the people working in it. And therefore, this remains a real, real challenge to the hemodialysis service and program modality in our country. Then labs, we have already talked about the laboratories, and they need to be upgraded. Then what is taking place? How do we mitigate? How do we go about to support and to have some of these challenges addressed? How the suggestions that are there is to increase the number of dialysis machines in those very, very busy centers so that they can be able to accommodate more patients and be able to increase their capacity to offer hemodialysis services. The other thing that is being worked on is to have centralized procurement of dialysis consumables, and this is being supported by the government. Then improving the laboratory services by equipping our laboratory and training our laboratory technicians. And they are being trained through YAKI and other training institutions. We have to enhance the NHIF coverage. We still need to lobby that NHIF covers more. We have patients who in some centers, and especially maybe the private centers, whereby over and above the 9,500, they have to top up because the cost of dialysis in those centers is slightly higher than 9,500. So as Kenya Renal Association, Kenya Nephrology Nurses Association, as key stakeholders in offering of services, we need to lobby that NHIF covers more than what it is offering now. We need to see it cover laboratory. We need to see it cover medications for kidney transplant and such. Then we need to improve and expand training capacity. We have IAKI coming up. We still need to have maybe other centers come up. We need to have more trainers trained and prepared to be able to handle this huge demand for training. Then standardization of renal services through Kenya Renal Association and Kenya Nephrology Nursing Association. We have many, many centers mushrooming, right, left, center, and everywhere. Some of them are not up to standard. Some of them are not offering quality. And the only way we can be able to do this is to standardize this through lobbying that we, these two bodies be given mandate to supervise and to inspect the quality of services that are offered in the, those renal units that are being opened, and even also to do a quality check for those centers.
Yes? Okay.
So then the other thing is to encourage and improve kidney transplant. We've seen this, the exit, we need to have an exit plan, and the exit we have is through kidney transplantation. We need to encourage our patients in all over the Republic that over and above hemodialysis, we need to prepare them for kidney transplant. And as I've said, and I repeat again, we need to capacity build for peritoneal dialysis, because hemodialysis is not the only modality that works. We need to encourage our patients, and also we as the service providers, we need to have ourselves trained or retrained and be able to offer peritoneal dialysis. The way forward is to move from accessibility, because accessibility was a challenge. It's still a challenge to some, to an affordability. We need to move from accessibility and affordability, because affordability is being also taken care of by National Hospital Insurance Fund, to enhancing quality renal services. We now need to talk about quality care to our renal patients. We need to push for more specialized trainings here locally and international. We need to create opportunity for our people to be able to access training in vascular access, in transplant, peritoneal dialysis, quality assurance, name them all. Let's create opportunities to have our people access training. And then let's have more renal nurses participate in the policy making in our respective counties, because they are the people on the ground. They're the people who deal with these patients. They're the people who know the challenges they are facing. Let us have them be involved in decision-making, not just offering services. Those are some of the services providers and some of those units. That's one of our unit in the national government, our water plant, in one of the renal centers. And thank you very much. I welcome suggestions and questions.
We have a question in the chat by, it is actually a point that we need to include some of these things in the syllabus of the higher deep nephrology nursing. Thank you, Mwega, for that input. And then there was another question for Grace. I don't know whether Grace is still in the audience, that someone was asking if there is, now that you have been in India, did you get other drugs that were cheaper than Sevelma? Because most of these phosphate binders in Kenya, they are quite expensive for our common man. Is there another alternative drug that can be cheaper? And then in the chat, someone was also asking, Mary Kipsoy was also asking, if we can, which alternative can we give patients for iodine, for povidone iodine and mipirocin?
I really cannot really explain the cheap drugs and the expensive drugs and the like, but I can say that the drugs in India are very cheap. Some of the drugs that are very expensive here, maybe they, by the time they come here, either the companies want to make more money or probably they are taxed by the time they reach the consumer. So really, I cannot say that this is cheaper or that, but the two drugs I mentioned are recommended in terms of safety. And this is where actually Chege is talking about lobbying for the patients. So that also NHIF can also cover some of these drugs. And also maybe the government can remove the taxes for the medical equipment and the drugs, so that the patients will benefit. We can overtax alcohol, beer, and cigarettes. But for the medicine, we try to make our patients be able to reach out affordable healthcare. And also for povidone iodine, it's good to avoid it. You can use other antiseptics. Like I said, there is ibuprofen in water, which is quite safe. And also normosaline is a very safe antiseptic. Even wound care nowadays, we use normosaline in the current wound management. And for povidone iodine, for mupirocin, usually is the best in terms of catheter exit care. The only thing is to avoid the mupirocin touching the catheter. So you just make sure it's on the exit site. You just make sure you just put a little, not so much, that will spill over to the catheter. Thank you so much. I hope I've been able to answer the questions well.